Are you singing some? Can you sing You Are Stronger? I just want to hear.
Can you sing that?
Oh, he paid it all upon the cross. Can I just hear your voice? Just sing anything. Oh, there you go. I thought your mic was way down.
I'm just singing a third above her. Hello, hello, hello.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. If you guys can go ahead and grab your seats, we'll get started here. I just want to spend a couple minutes to get our hearts like ready and settled as we prepare ourselves to enter into a time of worship. Mm-hmm. Spirit in everything that you encompass in and breathe out everything else. Yes. God, I pray that you would help us to just come to you for refreshment and that we would breathe out and release everything else that is distracting us, holding us down, just making things cloudy. God, I pray for your presence here to move within us. Will you open up our hearts and our minds? Help us to gain clarity so that you may move within our hearts. We pray for a time of refreshing, a time of just the ability to love each other, Lord. Especially with today being Father's Day, God, we just praise you and thank you for being our ultimate Father and for being the perfect example. Please bless this time of worship and hear us, Lord. In your name we pray. Thank you.
sons and daughters sing. We can hear the wind blowing.
You are strong.
consolation, the gift of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Be with us today as we come to worship you, to come to meet you, Father God. Would you open up our hearts to receive your word today, to receive you today, Father God. In Jesus' name I pray.
Go ahead and recite the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Before you get seated, please greet one another this morning and say hello. Good morning. Thank you. Yeah, we're watching. Worship this morning together with you. Happy Father's Day, like we mentioned, and we're just glad to be able to gather and just kind of not only spend time with one another together, but then also just see through worship, through song, also through the word, like what that means for us as a community. And so just really glad to see all of you here this morning. I didn't bring my notes, but in terms of the announcements, I know the big one is next week we're starting Sunday gathering again. As you know, our small groups are taking a break during the summer, and so we're going to meet right after service for food, most likely in the mezzanine, but also just stay tuned next week for more information. But right after service to eat together, to worship together, after worship rather, and then just spending a time, like a little different atmosphere where you can connect a little bit more, get to know each other in a different setting. So we invite you to come out tomorrow, next week for Sunday gathering at 11:15 p.m. or a.m., and we look forward to seeing you there. The passage for this morning is from the book of Luke, chapter 8. So we're going to look at Luke chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. And this is what it reads. It says, "They sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, 'What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me.' For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Jesus asked him, 'What is your name?' 'Legion,' he replied, because many demons had gone into him, and they begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and countryside. And the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, because they were overcome with fear, so he got into the boat and left. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away saying, 'Return home and tell how much God has done for you.' So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him." Amen. Let us pray one more time. And as we took some time before worship to pray and ask God for his anointing, his spirit, his presence to refresh us, to renew us. I'm just going to ask a similar prayer, asking the Spirit of God, please probe us, search our hearts this morning. And let everything of you remain, and let everything that is of me or my own thoughts, my own selfishness, let that just pass to the side, so that this time could be all about God. Jesus, it's funny how it's not even the questions that search our hearts. It's not even the questions that seek out and probe our thoughts. In many ways, just the act of silence or the presence of silence makes us pause and think and reflect, maybe even making us uncomfortable. And God, we thank you for that, because as we sit in silence and reflect and point our hearts and our minds towards you, we realize, Lord, that we're not alone, that we're not by ourselves, Lord, that you are in us and you are with us. We're also reminded, Father, that your ways are greater than our ways, your thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And this morning, as we come to you to look for your spirit, your word to be preached into our lives, to be proclaimed, the good news of Christ, we just want to say, let everything that is of us, of human beings, of selfishness, of sin, of fallenness, Lord, let that all just go by the wayside this morning. So that all that would remain is this pure light, truth, the word of God, the good news of God that gives life to our hearts, that brings life from death. May that be the only thing that remains in us. So that as we go forth from this place, we would take that into our lives, into our homes, into our relationships, wherever we go, and that the love of God would be proclaimed through us. We just thank you for this passage. We thank you for this day that we remember, not only Father's Day, but Juneteenth, and we celebrate our graduates as well. And we pray that as we just reflect this morning again, God, that your spirit would lead us in the only way it can. And we just really give you all the praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. More than 10 years ago, I was stuck in a job that I felt like had no future. I had been in that position for a few years, and I felt as though I had gotten all that I was going to get from that opportunity. And I kept on asking myself at that point, is this all there is for me as a pastor, a youth pastor, a worker? Feelings of hopelessness, dread, fear of the future overwhelmed me. And it was at that time that I had begun praying prayers where I didn't really even understand or realize that I was praying. I was just constantly, subconsciously sending up my personal SOS signs to the Lord, like desperately looking for him to throw me a life raft. God, are you out there? God, I feel like I'm drowning. Is anyone hearing me? And so somewhere at this point, I sent out an email to a well-known Korean-American speaker, asking if they would visit our church and speak to our congregation, our adults, our youth, about her work as a mental health counselor. Dr. Josephine Kim, her own story was shaped by the tragedy at Virginia Tech in 2007. And in the midst of such horror and loss, Dr. Kim was called upon to counsel and speak to students, faculty, families who were grieving the mass shooting that had happened that April. So I sent out an email, and in all honesty, I really didn't expect a reply. And so you can imagine my surprise when she responded asking for more information and sounded pretty positive and that she was interested. And several months later, Dr. Kim visited Bethel and talked about her work as a counselor and a bridge between the generations of Korean Americans. And for the first time in a long time, I think this community saw how important it was for us to heal together, to work on our relationships as parents, grandparents, children, peers, friends, colleagues, as one family of believers. Not only for our congregation, but also for me personally, that chance meeting and email response was an answer to my prayers. Remember those prayers that I just said I had lifted up, not knowing if anyone was listening or even paying attention. And I realized that in that moment that God was listening. And that's where I want to begin this Sunday, is a reminder that for all of us, no matter what you may be going through at the present time, and as we all have kind of journeyed together over the last several years through a pandemic and through different life circumstances, through ups and downs, and as we're in the midst of another series of trials and difficulties and challenges, the road ahead seems dark, like a dead end. The road ahead seems difficult and challenging, and there doesn't seem to be a lot of light and hope. And many of us may feel that, not just knowing that in our minds or realizing that cognitively, but maybe in our spirits, our hearts, maybe for one reason or another, we experience that a lot more fully. But I wanted to share that with us this morning because, again, no matter what uncertainty we may be facing this morning, I want to lift up the truth that God always hears, that God always is nearer to us than we realize. And that is the heart of a parent, the heart of a father, the heart of God towards each and every one of us this morning. And I wanted to start by asking us to realize that because, believe it or not, the word calling, can we say calling together? One more time, calling. That word calling is not reserved for God's anointed or elect or God's mouthpieces. It's not just reserved for pastors and missionaries and preachers. Each and every one of you has a calling. Can you repeat that with me? I have a calling. I am called by God. Each and every one of you has a calling, and that's not just some mysterious thing that we just kind of throw around to people when we're in situations. I've heard the word calling a lot used in churches and sermons and conversations, and usually it's along the lines of somebody doesn't understand what a pastor is doing or a missionary is doing, and they'll say, I'm called by God, this is my calling, and we're going to do it this way, or we're going to live it out this way. That's how most of the time I've heard the word calling used. But the reality is, each and every one of you has a calling, and that's a mysterious blessing from the Lord. But the best way that I could share it with you this morning is each and every one of you has God's hands around your life, surrounding you, holding you, sustaining you, lifting you up in ways that you may perceive, but also in ways that you probably don't perceive. And whether your faith is super strong and you're like, I don't have any doubts. Although I don't think that doubts is a sign of a lack of faith. That's another conversation. But whether your faith is strong, whether you're serving in the church, whether you have a title or a position or you're leading or whatever it may be, whether that's you or whether you're not, you're like, I don't know where my faith stands. I don't even know where I am with God this morning. I'm just here. I'm just trying to wipe the sleep off my eyes. Whatever the case may be, you have a calling from the Lord. You are called by God this morning. His hands are around your life, supporting you, sustaining you, lifting you up, giving you strength that you didn't realize that you had. And as I mentioned, I was at that road. And in the moment, in that situation, in that place, in that time, as is often the case, I felt like everything was crumbling around me. Like nothing to hold on to. Really just down. And when I look back now, as is often the case, I realize again that God had his hands around my life in ways that I couldn't really even begin to perceive. And me standing up here this morning is proof of nothing else other than God's faithfulness in our lives. Not only in my life, but in our lives. Not a day goes by that I don't thank God and also ask for his forgiveness. It might sound funny to say that, but in a sense, not a day goes by that I don't thank God and ask for his forgiveness for using somebody like me in a ministry like this. All of you probably deserve somebody way better than me. And yet, God to use me is something that I don't take lightly, that I'm so humbled by. And again, I wouldn't have planned my life to be like this. But again, it's that idea of calling. Not just for me, but for each and every one of us, we are called. From that first encounter with Dr. Joe that weekend, a series of events happened. My relationship with her as a mentee, her as a mentor, training me, teaching me, guiding me. But also with our church, kind of entering into this relationship with her and her nonprofit that she founded, Mustard Seed Generation. And this past week, we had a couple of visitors from Mustard Seed. To the right, that's Sharon. She's the executive director. She's based in Dallas, Texas. And she came along with Dr. Sam Kim, who's a psychologist from the University of Denver. And we were talking, brainstorming, meeting with some people here in our congregation as well as the KM about ways that we can help the church grow. Primarily in the area of mental health, as we've been talking about, but that's just a broad topic. But these conversations happened and just reminding me again that, wow, from that chance email, from the pit of my dead end, God had done something that was not just for me, but he continues to do something right now for us in this church. A sense of calling, a sense that he's got his hands around us. He's got his hands around this ministry. He is supporting us. And we don't know what the future holds, but we know that it's in God's hands. And that's the reminder that I was able to just glean this week about calling. God has called me. God has called us. And a lot of times when we lift up prayers like that, when we call out to God, those answers to prayer don't come immediately or in the ways that we anticipated or planned. However, they come. God's faithful. God really does not forget anything. And just hearing these stories and them listening to us and about our journey as a church, our 30-year journey, our 3.5-year reiteration of this, this EM, like God has been faithful. God is doing things. And it's not just because Reverend Timothy or myself are called, but each and every one of us are called to be here and to serve the Lord and to allow God's presence and spirit to guide us and lead us to do things for his kingdom, to build his kingdom. In a lot of ways, calling has to do with Father's Day, doesn't it? Today we celebrate and we remember our fathers, our dads. It's a day that we take time to say thank you. And fatherhood, kind of like the Shakespeare quote, some are born great, some achieve greatness, some have greatness thrust upon them. Fatherhood comes in all shapes and sizes. Today, we don't just honor our biological dads, but we realize that families come in all shapes and sizes. We honor our stepdads, who in some ways answer a greater calling to care for their children. We honor foster parents. We honor others who play the role of dad at home, in the classroom, at school, on the field. We know that today may not be an easy day for many of us. Maybe our fathers have passed on. Maybe our fathers were not present in our lives. As many immigrant stories and immigrant families can attest, there are a lot of us whose fathers had to pay a huge price in providing a life for us here in this country. I know many of us have had fathers who were traveling between continents, Korea and the States, and trying to figure out, piece together, trying to do whatever they could to provide for their families. And we know that that wasn't always easy for them, but also for us as children and spouses. And we don't just honor the good, but we also remember the difficult. And in a lot of ways, like, that's why I think of Scripture, and I think it gives such meaning to our conversation this morning. Because in the scriptures, the idea of calling and serendipity, God's chance meeting and provision for his people, it's not just reserved for the perfect. As we've said before here, God doesn't call the qualified, but God qualifies the called. And so when you look at scripture, it's not just the perfect people who live a perfect life, who do everything that God wants, that receive God's blessing and favor and faithfulness through the years. When you look through Genesis all the way to Revelation, you often see that it's the opposite. It's the people who don't seek God faithfully that somehow receive a grace that is so mind-blowing. You see that it's the families that are the most different, the families that are the most challenging, the relationships that are the most filled with sin and fighting and anger and rage and bitterness. You see, it's those families that God somehow and for some reason pours out his constant faithfulness. I'm never going to let you go. It's that truth that God says, this is my family, this is who I've called. Nobody can say anything about it. And that's what we see in Scripture. And I wonder what our community, our church would look like if we really, really, really understood that. Because I think in many ways we catch glimpses of it in sermons, but in our lived experiences here at church, we need to treat one another with that kind of respect and kindness and that kind of honoring of each other that God does with us. Not lifting up the people with the perfect families. Praise God for them. But also noticing the families and the people that whose situations, whose stories, whose backgrounds, whose current, you know, lot in life, they may not be exactly what we are used to. But again, if we're really students of Scripture and paying attention, what do we see is God is so faithful, especially to the people and places that you would never expect. And I think in that way, as we celebrate Father's Day today, we can celebrate the good, for sure. But also we can take time to celebrate and remember and acknowledge the difficulty of today for some. We can celebrate with those who are celebrating, and we can grieve and mourn with those who grieve and mourn. And that's the impetus for why I picked today's passage. Before we get to this idea of passage or the passage for today, not only was I thinking this past week about like my conversations and my relationship with Mustard Seed Generation and Dr. Joe, but also like how God had placed the right people in our congregation, in our church. Many of you know that I'm not a huge outdoorsman. We had a staff retreat this past week, and if you were here with us last week, at the end of service, I had shared a little bit about my hang-ups with my dad and kind of the struggles that I was going through. And the day after, I was supposed to take Harper on a field trip and then leave for Lost Lake. And so, you know, we had been ready, and Reverend Timothy had rented a couple of yurts. So you can imagine my excitement at going to a yurt. And so this was the weather. Lost Lake, it was like 40 degrees. As we were driving up, me and Pastor Sam, as we were driving up the mountain, I was seeing these like huge swaths of like brown stuff. And I was like, is that like thrown out cardboard? I had no idea what that was. And I realized it was snow that had melted like recently. So like cold, I think we were kind of ready. But then this is the rain that was there. So we got there about 5:30 p.m., and thankfully the sun was still, the light was still there. It wasn't sunny, but it was raining, and this is what we did. We huddled under this canopy. No, not all of us fit. There are other pictures if you want me to show after service, I can, but it's all wet. It's muddy. Reverend Timothy has, like, garbage bags around his feet. Kwangmun Jeon Sanim has slides on, no socks. And like it was like the greatest meal. It's like we're cooking over charcoal. There's like we had like probably about 50 cartons of butane gas. we were like cooking jjigae, and it, again, it was the greatest meal, but in the back of my mind, I'm like, where are we going? Are we staying here tonight? And long story short, we didn't. We ended up going to a motel about an hour away, but in that time that we were spending there, I was just like, again, reminding myself, thinking to myself, how did I get here? Like, how did all these people get here? And it, with Reverend Timothy, too, I was like, how did he get here? And was it just for me in that sense of calling? And like I said, last week I left this place sharing with you like how, you know, I was in just a really, really rough patch with my dad and thinking through this and what it means. And just that conversation and listening to Reverend Timothy and realizing, again, our journeys interweaving with each other in ways that I couldn't plan. In ways that, again, it's only God's calling that leads us here. And it's not just reserved for pastors, but it's each and every one of you. I think if you think about your life right now, how you got to where you are, you see fingerprints of God doing things, whether it's a relationship, a chance meeting, a school opportunity, a person, whatever it is. And God has his faithfulness in your life right now. God's calling. This is a picture the day after. We're kind of a little bit drier, and we were able to take it together. And just, again, so thankful for his faithfulness. And that's why I thought of this passage. Because, again, when I think of Father's Day, I think about, wow, Jesus had a father, God the Father, who sent him on this mission. And this mission, it wasn't an easy one. In fact, it was probably the most difficult and challenging and a mission that you and I would probably reject. And Jesus himself probably at times was really wrestling with, what do I do with this mission? I know what I have to do. I know where I have to go. I don't want to go there. We even know that at the end in Matthew 27, in Matthew's account, Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And this whole week I was thinking, what must have Jesus thought throughout his 33 years here on this earth about his father? And of course, the easy answer is, okay, Jesus being perfect and great, he was, you know, loved God and worshiped and all of that. But no, I think it's a valid question for us to consider this morning. What did Jesus think about his father? Was it all roses and perfect and I love my dad and you know, great walks along the beach and talks about what it means to be a man? And probably not. I think Jesus probably had a lot of difficulty with the fact that his heavenly father had sent him on this mission. Heavenly Father being perfect, God the Father, God the Creator, the Eternal, all good, all knowing. And so in his perfect plan, he had sent Christ. But in the execution of that plan, I'm sure there were so many challenges that Jesus was actually living out, feeling abandoned, lost, lonely. Maybe in that way, understanding what we go through. And especially here, this is in Luke's account that mirrors the Mark 5 account, Jesus' first foray into a Gentile population. And again, we're looking at these scriptures and we see that it's not all easy. Jesus doesn't just go out and preach the word and then millions of people come to him. No, he actually faces tremendous opposition, tremendous backlash for preaching this good news. Let me just read the passage one more time. Just feel it with me. They, meaning the disciples, sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. So it's not just a welcome party. It's not just a party that's saying, Jesus, you are the rabbi of Israel. We are here to listen to you. Please speak these words of life to us. No, it's not just a hostile person. It's probably the most hostile of persons, this demon-possessed man. Not just possessed by one demon, but a legion of demons. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me." For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven out by the demon into solitary places. So Jesus is met by this opposition, this demonic opposition. And you might be thinking, well, we don't really face that today, thank God, only in testimonies from missionaries. But it reminded me of Ephesians 6:12. For our struggles is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Which got me to thinking about Juneteenth. Many of us may not even know what Juneteenth is, but it was signed to be a national holiday last year. Juneteenth is a celebration that's actually rooted in the year of Jubilee in the Old Testament. 6 years of work, and the seventh year they rest, and every debt is paid, and there is the year of Jubilee of restoration. But Juneteenth is a celebration that, after the Emancipation Proclamation was signed in 1863, it took a whole 2 years for slaves to know that they were free. And so when the last of the Union troops got to, I believe it was Galveston, Texas, in 1865, letting the slaves know that they were free, you can imagine the celebration there. The year of Jubilee, celebrating a freedom from sin, a freedom from slavery, a freedom from evil and the demonic forces of evil that had plagued this country for hundreds of years. Which got me to thinking again about today. Because we still see the forces of evil. And it's not just a group of people that we demonize or fight against. If we're taking Ephesians 6:12 to heart, we're not fighting against people. We're not fighting against others. We're fighting against the demonic forces that are at work, the spiritual forces of evil that are at work, that Jesus himself faced here in Luke 8. Whether it's racism, discrimination against the black community, against the Asian community, whatever it may be, violence, hatred, evil, the oppression of the poor, whatever things that we're still seeing that are lingering right now, that are preventing true Jubilee from happening, that are preventing celebration, liberation, freedom as God intended his people to live in, whatever that is, we continue to fight the good fight. We continue to do God's work. Because in many ways, what is this passage if not at the heart of Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom, of freeing? And we see that Jesus frees this man from his demons, literal demons. And not just one, a legion of demons. And so this morning, I want to ask us, as we think about, this is Jesus' first foray into a Gentile land. And not just for the Gentiles, but for the Israelites, hearing the words of Christ wasn't always an easy thing. Like I mentioned with our families and the calling that God has placed in our lives, God doesn't just call the perfect. And for us that think that all of the Jews or the Israelites or the people of God receive God's word so easily, no, that's not true at all. We are reminded that it was the high priests and elders who actually sent Jesus to the cross. So even, quote-unquote, the people of God with the history as the people of God didn't receive the words of God well. The Gentiles didn't receive the words of God well. There was opposition. And so I ask us this morning, when the word of God is preached to us, how do we receive it? How do we receive this good news that Jesus is our Savior, that Jesus loves us and has given himself for us? If we agree with everything that we hear in a passage or the scriptures, chances are we're not reading it carefully enough. For us here at church, I was blown away by this quote. A church that meets all of our needs is probably a church that's off mission, because the church was never designed to meet all our needs. It was designed for glorifying God and showing his love to the world. And I wonder for us if this is a point of contention, if this is a difficult thing for us to hear. And let's not let that difficulty dissuade us or discourage us, because, as I said, when we really encounter the living God, because we are finite human beings, self-centered and in our own world, we oftentimes don't understand God fully. we oftentimes misunderstand what he's doing. And Jesus comes to this man and he does a supernatural work, casting these demons out, and he frees him. And this morning for us, I just want us to think and respond. Lord, help me to see clearly. Help me to respond to you, respond to this good news that more than the spiritual forces of evil at work in this world, more than the things that are going on that cause me to have despair and to be hopeless, Lord, you are greater. You are greater than these things. To this story, Tim Keller often notes that in the beginning of the story, you have this naked man, chained, living among the tombs. And then at the end of the story, you have him in his right mind, clothed, restored, ready to go back into his home and to preach the good news. And he notes that there is this cosmic transfer that happens, that Jesus himself takes the role of this demon-possessed man on the cross, exchanging places with him. That was a neat little observation from Keller. On the cross, Jesus is naked, filled with wounds, scarred, yelling out of his mind, while this man again is restored to his family. And that's the good news. That's the power of God through death that frees us, that saves us, that renews us, that gives us a new name and a new calling. And the end where this man is restored to his family, restored to his community, and telling others about what God has done. That is the picture of the church that I want us to have this morning. And so today I feel as we celebrate, and especially the graduates that from middle school, high school, elementary school, college, graduate school, especially for you this morning, the power of God is yours. The calling of God to look into the future, the unknown. It goes with you, freeing you and giving you a sense of purpose and calling and community. And for the rest of us, that same powerful calling is ours. Let's pray together. Father, we know that oftentimes there is uncertainty in our lives. And we struggle to make sense of many things. But yet, Lord God, you remind us time and time again that we are not alone. That in fact, we're called as your daughters and sons. And Lord, as we just respond to you this morning and hear this message and passage, God, that we would take it to heart. That whatever difficulties we are facing, Lord, that we would face it with courage, knowing that the power of Christ that freed this man is the same power that is with us today, giving us hope, giving us a sense of purpose, and not only for us, Lord, but for those around us, our loved ones, our community. Give us a sense of selflessness to share the gifts and the calling that you've given to us with others. Serving, sacrificing for them, as Christ has so perfectly done for us.
You broke.
us are trying to live into that calling. And it's a reminder that we receive, and then now we have to go live that out. And so we pray that that part of living out our freedom, God, that you would give us the courage and strength to do so every moment of every day. Not going back to that slave mentality, not going back to that fear-based mentality. Living with the good news and the power of Jesus that freed Legion from his demons is the same power that lives in us today, that gives us what we need to build the kingdom, to forgive, to love as Jesus loved, to follow his example. Thank you so much, Father, for we lift this up. We don't lift up a person or anybody, any organization, not even Bethel Church, God. We lift you up, Lord. You alone are good. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of our God the Father, who sent his one and only to die for us, the fellowship, and the power of the Holy Spirit may be with us all as we live into this freedom with the courage that God has won for us, day by day, step by step, living in hope, living in expectation, living in community, building the kingdom.